Physically based rendering materials are defined by three channels, which is the albedo, microsurface, and metallic channels. Any other texture types, such as the ambient occlusion, normal, height, opacity, and so on, all function as they usually do with any other kind of shader, as long as it sticks close to the industry standards of visualizing the fed data. To fully understand these three channels and what they're supposed to represent, we first need a basic understanding of light and its interaction with surfaces, as physically based rendering tries to imitate this behavior through these three channels, hence the name physically based rendering. As light hits a surface, it can either submerge into it, reflect off of it, or penetrate it. It is these three potential behaviors that defines decides the surface appearance. Submerged light enters the surface and scatters within it before resurfacing. The resurfaced light is referred to as refracted light or diffuse. Depending on the atoms of which the surface consists of, the color of the refracted light and the depth it will travel within the surface will vary. The depth of the scattering is important because it has a lot to do with the reflective appearance of the refracted light. Surfaces can be categorized into two types based on the reflective properties related to the absence or presence of metallic atoms. The first type is dielectric or insulative, which, because it contains no metal atoms, the light will scatter deep and wide through the material before resurfacing. The implications of this is that the original structure of the light will be lost and unrecognizable when it finally resurfaces. In addition, the resurfaced light will emit in different directions because of how it scatters within the surface. This means there is little reflective potentiality, and thus it will return a matte color of whichever color resurfaces. The second type is metallic or conductive, which is made of metal atoms. This will drastically reduce the scattering factor of the submerged light because the metal atoms reflect a lot of the light back before given the opportunity to absorb or scatter them. This in return means that a lot of the structure of the light that enter the surface is close to the same when it resurfaces. This is why metal surfaces are so reflective. The reflected light simply bounces off the surface before submerging into it. This is also referred to as specular light. Take note of the difference between submerged refracted reflection, such as with metal, and bounced reflection, such as reflected or specular lighting. Reflected light does not submerge into the surface, and thus therefore not share the color scheme of the refracted light. This means that the reflected light will always reflect in the color tone of the light source. This means that if you have a light source which is red and a surface which is orange, the reflected light or the specular light will reflect in red, even though the surface is orange. The clarity of the reflection depends on the uniformity of the light after the surface interaction. The deciding factor of this is the microscopic details of the surface. While reflected light is not absorbed, it is scattered in new directions upon impact. The more scattered the light is, the more blurred the reflected light becomes. So let's have a look at the albedo, microsurface, and metallic channels, and what role they play in imitating this behavior. The albedo channel is a RGBA channel, where the RGB channel holds the prime color values in red, green, and blue, while the alpha is actually free to contain pretty much anything, and isn't necessarily reserved for opacity. The albedo channel represents the color of the refracted light, which again is the light that resurfaces after it has submerged the surface, scattered, been absorbed, and eventually resurfaced. It is completely oblivious to any reflective behavior and is only about the color that escapes the light absorption process. The microsurface channel is the scattering factor of the reflected or specular light, which again is the light which bounces off the surface upon impact. Common scattering factors are surface layers such as dirt, moisture, dust, or physical damage which makes the surface uneven. Again, it's important to note that the microsurface channel has to do with the scattering of reflected light and has nothing to do with the scattering of submerged refracted light. The microsurface is a grayscale channel which controls the scattering factor by the brightness intensity. It has two popular ways of being represented, which is as a roughness channel or as a glossiness channel. They are the same thing, except their values are inverted from each other. The roughness channel implies if the texture is white, the surface is rougher and thus scatters the reflected light into more directions, making it appear blurred. The glossiness channel implies if the texture is white, the surface is smooth and thus reflects the reflected light uniformly and thus appears as a sharp reflection. The metallic channel has to do with the reflective behavior of submerged refracted light through the presence of metal atoms. As previously mentioned, metal atoms reflect a lot of the light back before it has a chance to be absorbed, and thus the submerged light will resurface unscattered. Because of metal's reflective properties, the environments will be reflected in the colors to a much greater degree. It is therefore important to change the environmental maps within your texturing software once in a while to see the appearance of the material in a different lighting conditions, as metallic surfaces will look very different depending on the ambient light of the environment it is in. The flatter the ambient light, or the more even the ambient light is to the highlights, the less contrastingly the material will look. Not all of the light will be reflected or absorbed, however, unless the metal appears completely black, which means that all the light that wasn't reflected was fully absorbed. Metal is therefore also colored through refracted light alongside of the reflected light. The method of which we give our metal a color depends on the channel, as the metallic channel also has two ways of being represented. The first is the metalness method, which uses a grayscale image to indicate which portion of the model is made of metal. A white color indicates that the surface is metallic, and black means it is dielectric. This method uses the albedo channel as the refracted light for the metal as well, so whichever color is in the albedo channel will be the color of the metal. The second method is specular albedo, which is a RGB image which indicates both the portion of the model which is made of metal and also the refracted color. This means it functions as both the metalness texture and albedo texture combined, but it is important to note that this method requires that whichever portion of the surface is metallic must have the same portion of the albedo texture rendered as black, or it will not appear correctly. Remember that this is not necessary for the grayscale metalness texture, as it gets its color from the albedo channel. Neither of the methods has a visual advantage over the other. It is just two different ways of handing the information over to the shader. The only difference between them for you is how you make the textures, and eventually how you can package them. And here are some examples of that. When using the specular albedo method, there is no need for the albedo channel if the entire surface is metallic. The refracted color and the metalness of the surface is both defined through the single RGBA texture file. What's left is the microsurface channel, and since it is a simple grayscale channel, the texture can be inserted into the alpha channel of the specular albedo. You then have all the PBR-defined material information in a single texture. This can make it very easy to manage files, for instance. For the Metalness method, both the metallic and microsurface channels are grayscale, so they can both be packaged into a single RGBA file. You can put the Metalness into the R channel, the microsurface into the G channel, and while you're at it, you can put the ambient occlusion into the B channel and any other texture into the A channel. This again makes it very easy to manage files. I hope this lesson gave you a basic understanding of the PBR texturing process. Stick around for more.